It's a beautiful day, and it's beautiful to see all your faces again. I missed you so much last week. I feel like I've been gone for an eternity. It was only one Sunday we missed. Funny how that feels, huh? And I'm sure glad I'm back. I'm sure glad you're here today, because the Lord's doing mighty great things in this place, and we're here to worship Him and give Him thanks and praise and glory. Glory for all the things that He's doing in our church. Would you join with me in prayer, please? Lord God, we thank You and we praise You because, Lord, we see You at work in this congregation. We see You at work in this community, Lord. So we invite You in now, Lord, and we pray for you to make Yourself known in this place and in this hour. Let Your glory shine upon us, Lord. Let us experience and encounter You through Your Holy Spirit, Lord, in this time. And Jesus, we got our eyes on You, fixed on You this whole time. So we thank You, Lord. We praise You, Lord. We give You this hour. We surrender everything else to You while we are here in Your presence and Your glory. And we say all this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Tell me if I'm too loud. The tendency. Just ask the wife. Next Sunday, our very own student missionary, Judy Hannah Aziza, will be bringing her experience of sharing the gospel in the Middle East to the pulpit. Immediately following our worship service, there will be a Q&A session in the sanctuary. So bring your questions and come hear what God is doing in the nations. Our annual ice cream social and silent auction have been set for Thursday, July 29th. Ice cream is needed. Now is the time to start preparing your favorite ice cream recipes. Ice cream tubs have been set out for you to take home and fill up. And Kalisha had a little announcement about the ice cream social.
Yes, we have 345 tickets out and 120 are paid for. So as you sell them, make sure and get the money in so I can get it to Ann and Helen, but as you sell them, that's fine. We have 21 of the containers filled with ice cream so far, and we have 12 different types of ice cream, which is a blessing. People like different kinds, so feel free to add to that. I know that everybody hasn't turned in their paperwork, and I have been guilty of that in the past, and that is okay. We're just going to trust that the Lord is going to bring enough food and everybody's going to be happy and it's going to be cool enough that we're going to enjoy our event. So anyway, I just wanted to give everybody an update on that. Any questions?
I got one question.
Yes, there's going to be tickets at the door, absolutely. And you can get tickets at Blue Flame and at the Cottage with Melanie Hicks. The other thing that I was going to mention, thank you, Dominic, you invited me. We have Dominic and Linda are going to help us set up in the morning. We do have FFA kids, but if we have a few more adults to help direct the FFA kids, because I'll be going in circles. And then we have two serving from 6 to 7, Doug and Lori, and then three serving from 7 to 8, Doug, Ted, and Deanne. And we have plenty on the cleanup. So just if you're able to fill in.
What time do you want the helpers here in the morning?
At 9 a.m. Mm-hmm. Let's do it when it's nice and cool.
Yes.
And with lots of help, it won't take more than an hour and we'll be good, is my plan.
That's actually
pretty good. Yeah. Yeah, 9 a.m. Let's get it when it's not too hot.
Right. Because at 9:45, it will be hot. That's been my experience this week. Okay. Steve, did you need to make an announcement?
Yeah, one quick little thing on this. On the ice cream social, Bob, I'm going to ask you for a huge favor. And because Lori's not here, can you hold the tickets?
I already asked him last night.
Oh, okay.
We're going to be out of town because we moved our golf vacation from when Vacation Bible School was, so that I can help with that. So we're actually leaving today after church, and so we'll be gone till Wednesday evening. So I'm going to leave extra tickets in case you need extra tickets with the church here, the Bob. See Bob. That way, I didn't want anybody not being able to get a hold of tickets.
Great. You guys are doing an awesome job. First time jitters, I know. You're doing a great job.
Well, I just trust in the Lord that it's all going to come together. Yes. Now never let me down before, so.
Does that sound familiar, Susan?
Okay, the next item for our announcements. Vacation Bible School has been set for the week of August 2nd. VBS will be held from 9 to 11:30 a.m. The theme for our VBS is Wildwood Forest. Discover the untamed nature of God. And Ranger Riley will be there to help you. That will be Dwight. So it's going to be a good time. Carol and Susan are looking for more volunteers of all generations to help with VBS. If you know any high school seniors looking for service project points, VBS will help them meet their goal. If you are available to help or know someone who is, please see Carol and Susan and let them know. And related to Vacation Bible School, this is the last week we will be collecting a special offering to support our VBS program, which is being offered at no charge for all who want to join. Following VBS, we are preparing to launch a Sunday school program for K through 5th grade. Offerings exceeding our VBS expenses will be applied to starting a new Sunday school program. And Bob, how many people are children are registered that you're aware of for VBS?
All families, 17 children.
All right, that's a good collection. Good luck, teachers. I'm not teaching.
Now, don't get too.
The upcoming meetings, the Board of Trustees will be meeting on Tuesday, July 27th at 7 p.m. Members are Ted, Ellen, Steve, Linda, Pat, and Bill. The Outreach and Missions Team will be meeting on Tuesday, August 3rd at 7 p.m. The meetings will all be held in the Education Building, conference room, and via Zoom for those who are unable to attend in person. Please see your bulletin insert for more information on what's happening in our church.
And now it's time for our opening hymn. If you'd like to stand and sing and give praise to our Lord, our God, we'll be singing Spirit Song, number 347. To lift up praises, to lift up thanksgiving to you, Lord. And Lord, we also have some things that are weighing heavy on our hearts, some things we're concerned about, so we give those to you as well, Lord. Lord, we thank you for always being attentive and hearing our prayers, Lord, and not just hearing, but acting upon them. So we thank you, Lord, and we give you praise. And I invite you who are here today to lift up your prayers, your joys, your concerns. I do have a couple of people I would like to lift up. I had a pleasure of going to see Betty as she was going through rehabilitation, and I was quite impressed with her. I caught her on the floor lifting weights. She was lifting those weights like this, and she was doing good. Although she's had a little bit of a problem with her blood pressure running low, so she had to finish the exercises in her room, but she was still doing the band and doing that. And she's so excited to be able to get out of there and come home. She knows she has to do the work first, so let's pray that the Lord will give her the energy to do the work, that he'll keep her blood pressure steady and where it needs to be, and restore her completely and quickly so she can come home again. And we also want to lift up Fern Lazzarati in our prayers as well. She fell this past week as well and broke her hip. I understand she's in tremendous pain, and so we just need to continue to lift her up and pray for her as well. Other prayers? Linda?
Can we pray for Aunt Linda? She's going to be leaving. I don't know if it's there for Mexico, one or the other. It's Friday night, and then she's going to be coming back Saturday night. And I have the joy that school is going to be starting soon, which means FCA is going to be starting again. I'm open to any ideas you guys have, because I have no clue what we're going to do on the first day. But I'm open to any ideas you guys have of what we can do to make it fun and stuff like that. So going to be in person again. Yeah. And then prayers for my Uncle Carl. They have set a surgery date for him, finally. Prayers that it all goes well, and the kidney's not rejected by his body. So just prayers.
What's the date?
I don't know. He just said they have a date.
But it's set.
He won't tell me.
Okay. So praying for Uncle Carl and for the successful surgery and full recovery.
Okay, I want to thank the Lord because we had a party last night for Rotary at our ranch. And when I set up the bar, there was so many bricks in it. It was very overwhelming to the point where I got very upset. And he gave me enough guidance, enough calming to say, okay, this is what I have to do. And it went off without a hitch. We were able to do some other workarounds, and everything worked fine. I think everybody that came had enjoyed the time. It was wonderful. The band was great. So things just went well, and I really appreciate it.
There's a problem usually when you have something in storage for since COVID, so it was in storage for over, 18
years.
So, yeah, kinks that needed to get worked out.
It got worked out, and I can testify it was a great event.
Right.
So praise be to God. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Was Kelly even just going to?
Not yet. Okay. Yes, Carolyn DeFrancesco is in the hospital. She has leukemia and will be undergoing treatments. I understand about 7 days of treatments, so she will be in the hospital for a while. And just prayers for her and her family. She's been through so much, and you know, it seems like we've been hit a lot in a short length of time. And so anyway, prayers for Carolyn and her family. Also yesterday, our son, we got a phone call yesterday afternoon that our oldest son, Brent, who lost one kidney to cancer about almost 10 years ago, had been taken to the hospital, and they were doing all kinds of tests and things on him. And so, of course, it was a big concern that it had to do with his kidney. And it turns out that it was a kidney stone. They are going to keep him in the hospital, but it was a big praise that that's what it was and that it can be taken care of. But I was telling Linda this morning, you know, we've talked about the spiritual warfare that's going on. there are so many people that are either involved in VBS or surrounding the VBS program that have been hit with just different kinds of things going on, physical. And so anyway, we thank God for everyone that's been involved, for all of the prayers, for all of the money spent, for all of the volunteers. And just know that I keep standing on the firm ground that we know who wins.
Amen.
God will be in charge, and this thing is going to happen. We're going to have VBS for the first time in Fireball in well over 10 years of any of the churches that I know of. So, yeah, we just looking forward to it.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Appreciate it.
Yeah, I'd just like to ask for traveling grace. We are going all the way to Pismo and then Napomo for fall. We'll be back Wednesday. And then a joy that we're going to be having the ice cream social the next day. And then the following day on Friday, Amelia from Germany will be here. And then on Saturday, Eleonora from Italy will be here. So by next week in church, we'll have both our girls. So that's a big change.
Amen to that. It's going to be an exciting season.
Yeah, I was just going to say, in the heels of what you just shared, Carol, because recently it's a joy also for our family to start going out. You know, Friday night we went to Blue Vein, we went out and had dinner together. And that was the time when Jen started sharing also a lot of her experiences. And then we met friends there from the community. And oh boy, they were saying, it's so good that you guys are bringing up VBS. They've been saying the community are so excited to hear that VBS is back because, you know, they know how much it is really a blessing to the community. And like you said, in 10 years, so they're excited as well. So I can see why there is spiritual warfare and, you know, just the struggle. But I'm excited. I believe that I can see really, you know, like it's the Holy Spirit really moving and bringing up the spiritual gifts of you, Carol and Janice here, and I'm sure everyone involved. And that's what he was wanting to do, that we start really going outside of the corners of our church and really blessing the community. And so this is happening. And so that's why the enemy is not happy, because we are gaining back ground. So let's just press on, and we know who the winner is. And I'm hoping that Jack can also get involved in some way while she's here with VBS. And so that's a joy and a prayer. I'm really praying for VBS too. And then another thing is that, the Q&A for Judd next Sunday after her testimony, please bring your questions, not only related to ministry or missions, but even, you know, there's no trivial question. I'm sure Judd will welcome anything, even those questions that are out of curiosity, but please ask your questions. I'm sure you probably have questions already from just reading her monthly newsletters, so please come and hear her testimony as well as get to know deeper by asking questions. So
tell others.
Yeah, and tell others too. And then prayers that Chad and her going back to school this fall will also fall into place, as well as her ministry there, because she's also continuing to do her ministry there. And for Jolo also, as we're trying to see how he can go back to school again now that things are opening back up. So prayers for both. Thank you.
I just thought of another joint. My friend has her wedding date set, and was it yesterday or the day before, she asked me to be her maid of honor, so I was extremely honored. But I don't even know what to do in that position, so I guess I just walk. But her date is set for Christmas Day. I'm not excited about that.
So I just want to ask my family in Christ here to keep me and my family in prayer. Same thing, when you're trying to take things to the next level with the Lord, the enemy will try to come and bring discouragement, but God is worth it.
Amen.
To push it forward. So I ask that you please keep me and my kids in prayer. Also, I have a job interview on Tuesday. So if you guys please keep that in prayer, that God would give me a favor. And also, I'm very grateful to the Lord. Didn't think, as I shared a few weeks ago, that a few years ago, I thought I had no son anymore. And he turned 10, so God has given him an extra year of life. I'm very, very grateful for it, because I know that he may not have been here.
Amen.
So
yes. Other prayers?
First of all, I want to thank all of you for praying for Mike. I'm going to ask for continued prayers. As I walked out the door today, I said, you're going to have a bunch of Methodists praying for you. And he said, I know, I can already feel they are. Just pray. He's really fighting this infection right now. And, you know, he had the emergency surgery last week to replace the knee replacement. He has a temporary one, and he knows that he's going to have to go through the same thing in a few more months once the infection is gone. But please, I need strength, and I feed off of his, what's the word I'm looking at? Determination and his constant never giving up, and I feed off of that. And he's just a little low right now, so if you guys could just keep him in your prayers and me as well, because somebody mentioned the six-letter word school, and it's starting back up. And, but anyway, that'll be starting up, and he's on IVs and all that stuff. So I just need strength, and Mike also. Appreciate it.
Amen.
I just want to thank everyone for their prayers for my mom and I. It means a lot to us. And mom made sure, I told her I was coming here before I go to see her. And she said, well, you make sure you tell everyone thank you. And I just want to make sure that everybody knows that. And, you know, I was listening to Steve about, you know, when things happen and that, you know, that frustration and that, whatever. I've felt the same thing, Steve, and I felt the Lord just keeping me right where I need to be. And it's just so powerful, and it's just such a blessing. And one more thing that relates to our beautiful small-town community, I love this. When I was in the rehab the other day, I was walking down the corridor, and someone said, Mrs. Janice! And, you know, no one in there even knew my last name, you know, so I'm thinking, what? And, of course, I had my mask on. Well, it was a former student of mine, and it just, that always just warms my heart that, you know, people recognize and remember and just that wonderful little connection, you know, and that's just a way God's speaking to me too, I think. So anyway, but we really are truly thankful and blessed in so many ways. So I thank you all.
Amen. Other prayers?
Yes. Sharon fell cancer for 2 years, and now we're going through the regimen she was on could mess with her heart. So just asking for prayers if all that goes through.
Amen. Sure. Yes?
Can we also keep my aunt for it?
Yes. Brandon. Amen.
Just let's all put our hearts and hands and prayer line together for all the fire and first responders that are out there. I know Paul Demers is on the border of Nevada and California working the Dixie Fire. And there's so many people out there. We just all need to pray together as one unit to bless those people, protect them, and a little rain from the Lord would be nice. So carry your umbrellas and we'll be positive prayer people.
Amen. Yes.
I would just reminding everyone, Thursday is our ice cream social and the silent auction. I need items for the auction. I will be here most of the day Wednesday for any drop-offs and all day Thursday. And I'll take it to the last minute.
Okay, auction items needed. CL. Okay. Anything else? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you and we praise you for all the things that you do to cover us, to keep us safe, to keep us from harm, Lord. For those who, Lord, have been encountering difficulties through illness or other ways, Lord. And those especially associated with the EGS, we just pray your protection over them, Lord, that you cover them and keep them, let your face shine upon them, Lord, bring them in peace, and Lord, just keep them safe from any attacks from the enemy, Lord. That goes for all this congregation, Lord, as we continue to lean into you, as we continue to become obedient to your ways and to your word, Lord. We know that the enemy is not going to like it, Lord, and he's going to make us a target. So we just pray, Lord, that he will have no effect, that through our faith and through, Lord, your heavenly host and your mercy and your grace and the Spirit of God that lives in us, Lord, he will have no effect on our lives in any way, shape, or form. So we commit this congregation, Lord, this community to you, to your grace and mercy. Lord, we continue to pray over this community and over this nation, Lord, that through your church, with Jesus Christ as a head, we would find a way to bring peace and reconciliation once again into our nation. I know it's a lot to ask, Lord, but nothing is beyond you. So, Lord, we pray that you would raise up those who would speak love, speak kindness, speak gentleness, but speak the truth, Lord. Reveal those things that have been done in the dark and reveal them in the light, Lord, so that we can all come to agreement on, Lord, what is right and, Lord, what is not. So, Lord, we just set all these things before you. We pray that you work in these things, Lord, and that you cover all the leaders in our nation, Lord, that they would come to know your ways, come to know your will, and come to know your heart, Lord, for your people, for your nation. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for all those who you've risen up, Lord, through your church. Lord, who those encourage those maybe who don't know your ways and your will. Lord, we just pray you keep surrounding our leaders with your word in one way or another, Lord. Lift them up, Lord, and encourage them the way that only you can. Lord, we remember all the other nations, Lord, and all the missionaries that are out there serving and taking your word, Lord, to people who haven't heard it yet. We praise you and we thank you for your work in these missionaries and through them, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to pray and to bless, Lord, those who have been served, those who have turned to you, those who have received your Son, Jesus Christ, as their Lord and Savior, those who have been baptized, Lord, especially those in the Middle East, Lord, where the work is very difficult, Lord, and there's a lot of spiritual work and there's a lot of attacks. So we just lift up all those families, Lord, that have been served in this year, Lord, that you would keep them, Lord, and that you would keep them whole, and that through your Son, Jesus Christ, and through your Holy Spirit, Lord, that they would stay on your path, not here to the left or here to the right, Lord, but always hear your voice calling them back into your ways, Lord, and keeping their eyes focused on you. So we thank you and we praise you, Lord, for all these things, Lord. We lift up all these prayers, Lord, for those who are tuning in online, for all the prayers that are upon their lips, upon their hearts, upon their minds, as well as ours, Lord. We lift up all these things to you, that through your mercy and through your grace, your will and your purpose will become lived out in our lives, and we will see your kingdom advancing with power, Lord, with power and with grace. So for all these things, Lord, we give you praise, and we pray, Lord, as one body in Christ Jesus, praying the way that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now we're going to take up a special offering for our Vacation Bible School. So if I could have the ushers come forward. Kentucky to attend the Aldersgate event on the Holy Spirit encounters And there's so many things that happen, we'll never possibly cover them in this hour. But we're going to share some of it with you today, and it's my joy to invite Steve up to share his experiences with you. Let's give him a clap.
Sure that everyone understands that when I went to Altar's Gate, I went with a very open mind. I didn't want to have any preconceptions because I had been to revivals before and it kind of could be true, could be not. So I felt I had to give them a chance because I've seen the wonderful work that the Altar's Gate does in the Gilberg family, and how they come back from it so recharged. It really is, it looked like it was a good thing, and I was excited about going up to it myself. The trip to Altar's Gate was a very awakening and very joy-filled way, in a very joy-filled way. I am reading this because of my rough week. We arrived on Wednesday the first night, and I had the opportunity to set up a prophetic prayer. Okay, thanks for the correction. For the next day, the team that did the prophetic prayer were very great. They prayed for quite a while over my experience to come to Altar's Gate. And the woman told me that she had a vision. And I kept sticking my hand into the water, the still water. And then, take it back. And then stick it in again, and then take it back. So I did this several times. Finally, I stuck it in, and the other hand grabbed me out of it. That was her vision. And I found out I was off to a great start. Because I felt after the weekend that she was very, very bright. On the second night, things really started changing. Because I started seeing more of the personal prayers, and the praise band just seemed to be singing directly to me and my issues. And the easiest way to say it, after it was all the speakers were starting and I was beginning to feel more and more fulfilled, everyone just seemed so friendly, so caring. There wasn't an angry person in the house. And it really, at the end, they offered the personal prayer. And I was still, I don't know, that's the first time I saw people, Jesus Christ taking over, and saw people going up, and I don't know if I'm really ready for this. Well, on the third night, after the speakers were finished, I was all in. And as I stood, shared my preaching from March, I had unresolved issues with my father. I was going to see if I can get some guidance about the dealings with him. And when I got to the front of the line, I told Aaron, hey, I've never done this before. I'm a little nervous and these type of things. And Aaron prayed over me. When he was finished, I felt very comfortable, very confident in going to get my personal prayer. I'm very relaxed, no problems, and then the personal prayer. It was Harry and Ann who did the personal prayer. Both of these prayers were done by two people. And I asked, they asked me to start by telling them what had happened. I couldn't go into great detail, but I kind of stayed on the edge and got the gist of it. And we started praying. I felt very warm in my chest. Just warm. And we kept praying. My eyes are closed. And at that point in my life, when I closed my eyes, I saw black. I didn't see any colors, any visions, any no reflections even. And all of a sudden, after a little bit more praying, blood red crimson is what I saw. Just a little bit. And then it turned white. Very bright white. Very much like Joy's dress. Very bright white. And at this point, it kind of looked a lot like Isaiah 1:18, where, let me get down to it. Come now, and let us reason together, said the Lord. Through your sins, though your sins are scarlet, they will be white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be wool. This kind of falls into everything. I got a lot, by the way, from the gentleman over here to help me to understand what I was going through. And now, when I close my eyes, I see the face of this church in a grayscale, wool-like color. And I feel like the weight that has been on me for 43 years is gone. I don't have any more with my dad. I don't have any more anger anymore. I'm caring for that side. When I woke up the next day after all of this, I felt great. And I always, I work very hard. And I always wake up with back pain. From just basically overdoers back. And I woke up, I had none. I was walking tall. I felt very relieved and very grateful since the experience. I have been praying and reading the Bible daily for quite a while. But now I feel blessed to do it in the morning before my day starts. Which is a suggestion by your pastor to do prayer in the morning. And I was rude, I wasn't doing it. but it has changed everything since I started. I'm able to deal with the stresses much easier without getting as upset as they being an exception. But we kind of go through those things, but I guess we get through them. And it kind of, my life now kind of reminds me of Psalms 105, verse 1. Give thanks to the Lord for praying his greatness, and let the whole world know what he has done. The Lord has healed me. Jesus Christ is here inside me.
Hallelujah.
And like I said, this is all done, this experience of the personal prayer me and Bob talked about both on the trip and a little while after. And he explained to me that in Isaiah, Jesus covers me with his blood and in the red image. And then in doing so, he cleanses me to the right, the very white, the snow image. And then the vision of the church, this is God letting me know that I need to bring this same spirit back right here. With me. The church, there are others in the church who are in need of healing from their past. And I will be going back next year. And I will invite anybody who wants to come. Because I think it will be a good thing. Because I'm enjoying a new journey with Christ. That I am on. I'm looking to see where it goes. And I can't wait for all the goodness that he has planned for me.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Anybody know the thing, transformation in this man? Right?
Holy Spirit.
I
Steve, thank you. Thank you, Bob, for assisting us on getting him to go with you. All right, if the readings for today, the first reading is from the 23rd Psalm. I think we're almost all familiar with that Psalm. So if you'd like to open your Bible to Psalms 23, I will fear no evil. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And for the second reading, if you feel willing and able to stand for the Gospel of John, chapter 7, verses 37 through 39, the verse of living water. On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water." By this he spoke of the Spirit, whom those who believe in him would receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Would you be in prayer with me, please? Lord, you are such a good and gracious God. Lord, to allow us to witness your healing, spiritual healing, your emotional healing, and your physical healing in one of our brothers, Lord, to be witness to that and to hear his testimony, Lord, and to glorify your name in that. It's just such a joy to be a part of. So we thank you and we praise you. And so, Lord, as we come before you, as we reflect on your word, which has been read, and the message has been prepared, we just pray that you would take over, that you would capture our minds, and not that be paying attention to what I'm saying, Lord, but paying attention to what you are saying. In other words, you're convicted that it is you speaking to their hearts and to their minds. And make shine, Lord, for them, whatever you will make shine for them in this world. And so for these things, Lord, I give you praise and I give you thanksgiving. And we lift up all these things to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So I was planning on preaching on fasting this week, but the Lord, had given me something else to preach about. So we're just going to defer that a little bit. Matter of fact, it won't be next week either, because next week we're going to have our guest preacher, our old missionary, sharing her story and her experiences. But that was to leave 2 weeks for me to complete my preaching and teachings on fasting, because we will still be doing an all-church fast on August 29th. I'll be calling it out, and I know everybody's going to be excited to be a part of that. Matter of fact, I have it on good word from one of our sisters who went over to the Full Gospel Church and talked to Pastor Ron Leva, and she was saying, we're so excited for this event on September 4th that's going to happen at Maldonado Park with the Warriors of Faith and all the praise men and all the preachers that are going to be coming. Our church is going to do a fast. He said, really? So is ours. So we're going to have two churches fasting for this event, because we're fasting for deliverance and salvation of people who do not know Christ yet. That's the reason we're doing this. This is the reason we're working for it. This is the reason we're going out. And because we're going to be fasting for this, we know we're going to have God's favor over it as well. So it's going to be an exciting time, and you're all invited to be a part of that. And as I was reflecting upon all the things that the Lord had revealed when we were in Kentucky at the Aldersgate event, both for Steve and myself, and and even how those things that happened in Steve's life and the things that were revealed to me work together. I was just so excited. I'm still overflowing. That might come out in my word today. Just might notice a little bit of overflowing of the Holy Spirit. Just reach out and grab it if you can. It's all free. It's intended for you. But it reminded me of when I first came. Not the first time I came, because the first time I came to Fireball, my very first time was in February back in 2019, a few months before I would start my appointment in July. And we met with the SPRC, and our district superintendent was here. And probably because she was here, you know, I didn't really get to hear what the people were thinking. But we came back in June, just the month before that I would start. We met with the planning committee so I could get an idea of what would be going on and what would be happening in July, so I wouldn't come in on the first week and kind of be blindsided. But what I experienced, I wasn't expecting. I experienced a broken church, one that was grieving, one that was angry. And I heard their testimonies and their stories and the preachers that had come before me that were preaching everything but the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I could understand the disparities that you were feeling and what you had gone through. And so I just made one promise, one simple promise to you, that I was told we wanted to change. And I said, okay, we're going to change. We're going back to the Word of God. To His good word and nothing else.
Amen.
His word and His spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And so I still remember, I'm sure you do too, my very first sermon. Maybe you all remember that. It was Psalm 23. I selected Psalm 23 because I knew we needed a time of restoration. And I only preached on the first three verses because we needed to spend time in green pastures beside still water so God could restore our souls. And we spent a great deal of time there. So if you have your Bibles, you can open it up to Psalm 23. We'll just take a look at those three verses again, just in case you forgot what I said. In the first verse in Psalm 23, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Because when we lean into the Lord and we trust in the Lord, He provides everything we need.
Amen.
Everything we need. Because those who follow God will lack nothing. They will lack nothing that is necessary for God's purposes to be accomplished in their lives. And He has a purpose for each and every one of you. They will be content with how the Good Shepherd cares and provides for them, even in times of trials and tribulations. Because they trust His love. We trust His love and His commitment to us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So, we shall not want, because everything we need, God provides for us. And in verse 2, He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. I just love those still waters, don't you? To be still and quiet and present before our Lord our God. Because of the presence and the nearness of our Good Shepherd, God's sheep that is us, can lie down in peace and be free from all fear. And we know this from 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, that there is no fear in love because perfect love drives out fear. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. And God's love for us is perfect in every way. And it's His love that dwells inside of us. We are the ones that hold His love, because He wants us to share His love. So if you think He's going to hold back His love from us, no, He's going to let it overflow in us, because it's expected to be shared. And Jesus, as His Son, brought this promise for those who will follow Him. He said He would send His Holy Spirit to be our helper, our counselor, our comforter. And it's the Holy Spirit who intercedes for Christ, imparting Jesus' care and presence upon us, upon those who believe in Him. And in this, confidence and peaceful rest become our green pastures. And this idea of green pastures is a figure of speech for what makes a person grow and thrive in this lifetime. And we know true growth and life come from a personal and deep relationship with Jesus and with His Word. As recorded in Scriptures, both are necessary for living a truly fulfilling life because He does expect to have a relationship with us, a relationship where we speak to Him, where we call upon Him, where we pray to Him. And He hears us, and He speaks back to us, and we understand what He's saying in the many, many beautiful ways that He reveals His will and His Word to us. Amen?
Amen.
He leads us beside still waters, bringing us peace, and bringing us life, and bringing us the refreshment of the Holy Spirit. Can you tell I'm still overflowing? And then verse 3, He restores my soul. He restores my soul and leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. In our Christian walk, there will be times. There will be times when we become discouraged. And it's in these times when our Good Shepherd is with us and revives us and re-energizes our souls through His power and through His goodness. And this is why it's so important that you hear Steve say, start your day, every day, with His Word. Before you check your Facebook or your Instagram, before you check your email or your calendar, spend time with God's Word and see how your days will be different when you do that each and every morning. He leads us through His Holy Spirit onto His chosen path, equipping us to fulfill His perfect purpose for our lives. And this is our response. This is the only response required and the only response we can give, and that is obedience. Obedience to His Word. Obedience to His voice. For we follow the Shepherd and we hear His voice and we know His voice as He calls us by name. Every one of us, He knows us deeply and personally. And He wants you to know Him the same. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So like Steve, I also had made an appointment on that first day before the event kicked off. Made an appointment for the prophetic word ministry team. I just tell you, this is just such a blessing and such a ministry that comes through Aldersgate. Now, when you meet with this team, you meet with somebody you don't know. At first, I got sat with two people that I knew very well. So we talked for just a minute and said, okay, I'm going to go somewhere else to somebody who doesn't know me, because that's what it's all about. To sit with somebody who doesn't know you, because they want to listen for a word from God. And if they know you and know about your life, then, you know, their voice might interfere with hearing from God. So I moved over to a couple that I didn't know, a young couple, Tiffany and Caleb, a beautiful couple. And I sat with them, and, you know, all we do is we just introduce each other. And then we sit in silence for a period of time. So we sat in silence for about 5 minutes while they were listening for what God would have to say. What word He had for me. And if it's for me, you can bet it's for this church too. Amen? Amen. And so after they were listening, Tiffany shared a couple of encouraging words for me that helped lift me up and encourage me in every way. She gave me a song to listen to, which really spoke to my heart. And I greatly appreciated that. But then Caleb said, well, I just got two quick things, just two really quick glimpses that God showed me. He said, in the first one, you were in it, and I could see you from about here up. And you were hovering over the water, and the water was still, a sheet of glass. And as you were leaning over the water, that tip of your cross dipped into the water, but it was not disturbed. And that was the first one. And that brought me right back to where we started 2 years ago, where I saw the state of the church and knew we needed to spend time in green pastures and beside still waters. Caleb didn't know that. He had no way of knowing that except for a word of knowledge from our good Lord, our God. And I was just like, whoo! And the Spirit within me was going, that's right. He's speaking exactly what you need to hear. And the Holy Spirit explained it to me. And I was like, but then there was a second vision. And in this vision, he saw a waterfall, a great and mighty waterfall, one well known. He says, I know this one. It's in Hawaii. You see it in a lot of movies. And he said it was gorgeous all around it. He said there was a very much of a great rushing, very loud sound, with a lot of water pouring down and a mist coming up. And you might say, well, Pastor Bob, what does that mean? I wasn't even in that vision, just the waterfall. But the thing he didn't know, and the thing I hadn't shared with too many people, one or two people at that point, shared with a couple more since, is a vision that God had given me a number of weeks earlier. Because you all know what God has placed on my heart. You know that God has placed on my heart to go out into our community and to partner with the churches and the pastors and the faith leaders of our community to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to those who haven't known him yet, who haven't developed that relationship with him yet, those who are living in spiritual darkness. And so I had met with three other churches, three pastors, and a few other faith leaders in community one by one. And each time I met with them, I shared what was on my heart and how God was speaking to me and what he wanted us to do. They were all excited. The Spirit that was in me was overflowing upon them, and they were so excited to get engaged with what God wanted us to do. And so the time came, and I set up a meeting. We all agreed on what would be the best day. We all agreed what would be the best time. And I said, okay, wonderful. I set up the meeting. I set out the reminders and let everybody know. And I was so excited for what God was going to do in this. And then the first pastor called and said, well, I can't make it. I got to tend to my crops. And the second one called and said, well, I can't be there. I just got bought a house. I got to close the deal. Another one said, oh, I can't be there because I got something else I just have to do. And every person, not one person, kept that point. And I knew the enemy was at work. I know he was subverting and delaying, not defeating, but delaying what God wanted to see happen. And I had to confess at that point. I had to confess because if we're going to do something like this that God wants us to do, we've got to take it to the heavenly realms. We've got to engage in spiritual welfare because the devil's not going to like what we're doing and he's going to bring us under attack. And so I had to confess to God I wasn't spending enough time on my knees praying for this and fighting against the world which works in opposition to the Lord, to our God. And so I came in for weeks, almost every day, into the sanctuary. And I turned on the worship music. And I worshiped God. And I praised God. And I prayed to him in my common language, in my heavenly tongues. And at one time, when I was praying and worshiping him, he showed me a vision in which I could see all of Fireball in one view. And as I was looking down O Street, down Main Street, I saw erupt out of the ground a gusher of water. And it just shot straight into the air, overflowing, just a tremendous amount of water. And then another one erupted, and then another one, and another, and so on. And at first I was confused. I was confused because I said, what are you trying to show me? Because my mind immediately went to the flood in Genesis. When we read that story in Genesis 7, verse 11, it says, all the fountains of the great deep burst open. And then the floodgates of heaven were open. The flood started with pressures coming out of the earth. And he said, no, that's not it. Look again. And I looked again and I saw rivers of living water pouring out of the ground all across our community, washing everybody, white as snow. So now you can see how Caleb's waterfall vision perfectly aligns with the vision God had already given me. He's ready to pour out his spirit in mighty and powerful ways. All we've got to do is prepare to act upon his word and do the things that he's calling us to do. Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. So we see from these visions as they work together for this body, for our church, and for our community. And this is the purpose of prophecy. It's not prophecy like in the days of old, where prophets were standing up to the kings and telling what God's going to do if you don't get things together. But these are prophetic words to encourage, to edify, to build up the church, and to let us know that God's blessings are upon us, and to let us know what he wants us to do, and that he's ready to act if we're ready to act. Amen?
Amen.
And we know this because Paul says in 1 Corinthians in chapter 14, he says, he who prophesies speaks to men for their edification and exhortation and comfort. He who prophesies edifies the church. And he says, I desire that all speak in tongues, but even more that you prophesy. Amen? Amen. Because it does. Aren't you encouraged by what you heard? Aren't you encouraged with what God is doing? It's his prophetic word. Not mine, not Caleb's, not Tiffany's, not Steve's. It's his prophetic word lived out through the church and lived out through the body. Amen? Amen. And so we have these prophecies over the church, and there's more that I've shared, to edify us and to let us know that God's favor is upon us and that he intends to use this body, this church, to advance his kingdom with power and with glory. Power through his Holy Spirit, glorifying Christ Jesus and our Heavenly Father, and in doing so, drawing people to Christ. Amen. And this is my promise to you. Those online and everyone sitting here today, the more the members and congregants of our church become disciplined. Disciplined in reading scriptures daily. Spending time in prayer daily. Faithfully attending Sunday services each and every week, and growing deeper in faith through the study of scriptures and Bible study. And I know there's a lot of people doing it more than there was before, but there's still a few out there that haven't plugged in. And the more and more that people plug in and start doing these things, the more we will see rivers of living water poured out over our congregation and out over our community to the glory of God.
Amen.
Amen. Are you getting excited? I am so excited. Oh yeah, I'm overflowing. And with this, like at Steve's experiences at Aldersgate, we see the following promises of God being fulfilled in our church. From the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 14, Jesus says, whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water that I shall give him will become in him a well of water springing up into eternal life. And from the Old Testament, Zechariah, chapter 14, verses 8 to 9, the Lord says through his prophet, on that day living waters shall flow out of Jerusalem, half of them to the eastern sea and half of them to the western sea. It shall continue in the summer as in the winter. And that promise is for us as well, in this time as well. Amen? And in Revelation 21:6 and 22:1, he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give of the spring of water of life to him who thirsts. Are you thirsty?
Hallelujah.
Then he showed me a pure river of the water of life, clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And from our gospel reading this morning, John chapter 7, beginning with verse 37, on the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scriptures have said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. By this he spoke of the Spirit, whom those believe in him would receive. Amen. Amen. And amen. Praise. I just continue to think about that image of steam. Hand in the water. Hand out of the water. Hand in the water. Hand out of the water. And oh! Fully submerged. Baptized. Amen. Praise the Lord. And these verses that I just read, these are verses about rivers of living water. Jesus is referring to his gift of the Holy Spirit. When we start living into the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit, these gifts of living water will overflow. Not just in the church, but beyond the church, in your home, in the community. And before long, and even Pastor Ron saw the same vision. People would be leaving out of Fireball, taking that same spirit with them, and planting churches in other places. Amen? Amen. Amen. That's God's plan for this community. It is the Holy Spirit that guides and empowers Christ followers in a way that allows us to experience his overflowing in this life. And as Christians, as followers of Christ, as we respond to the Spirit's direction and exercise of power, this living water will flow out of others, out to others, with spiritual healing. Life-giving messages of Jesus Christ. Yet I do want to tell you that scriptures come with a warning as well. And we need to pay heed to this. From Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 13, the prophet says, O Lord, the hope of Israel, all who forsake you will be ashamed. For you say, those who depart from me in the earth will be written down because they have forsaken the Lord, the fountain of living waters. Amen and amen. The fact that, that Steve, through his prophetic word ministry, had a vision about water. I had similar visions that overlap with everything in the church. I hope you can see how God's hand is all over this. Amen? Amen. Amen. So as we examine Psalm 23, in the light of these other scriptures, we come to understand that God restores us in order to equip us to be his instruments of light and hope in the world. So let's take a closer look again. If you have your Bibles open to Psalm 23, I encourage you to follow along. In verse 3, once again, he restores our souls and leads us in paths of righteousness, so we will become the life of Christ in the world to defeat the works of the enemy, that is Satan, the works of darkness. And we know again that this is true. This is our promise from God that we have assurance in. From the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 5, it says, the light shines in the darkness, but the darkness did not overcome it. Amen. When you're walking with the light of Christ inside of you, the darkness will not overcome you or your life or God's purpose and plans for your life. Amen. 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 And then in verse 4, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we fear no evil. For we go out into the world as ambassadors for Christ with the authority and the power of Christ in us. That is, with the Holy Spirit overflowing through us. And in this, we are promised victory. In verse 5, God prepares a table for us in the presence of his enemy. And he will anoint us to complete this work which he started in us, which he prepared for us in advance. And in doing so, our cups will run over like rivers of living water. Amen. In verse 6, surely in that time, surely his goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and he will dwell with us for all of eternity. That is our hope. That is our promise. Amen. But I want to tell you these things that Steve and I encountered at Aldersgate are happening here too. And like I said, the more and more we're acting upon God's word and doing the things we've been talking about, the more and more these things are going to happen. And so I'm going to invite Regina up to share a testimony she shared last week with us in Bible study. Regina, would you please come up and share?
Last month, I was feeling kind of discouraged because it's been 6 months and I've been waiting for my breakthrough to come through. And anyway, God spoke to me. He's like, how much can you trust me? I trust you. Trust you. Well, first came and discovered I had no more income, no more help. And all of a sudden, my anxiety was starting to nag at me a little bit. And God was like, how much do you trust me? And I trust you. I trust you. So then my birthday month comes. And anyway, I spent my birthday not thinking about myself, but praising God just for who he is and what he's done and just how much he loves us. Loves me, loves all of us. And so... then the next day, Wednesday night at Bible study, we had prayed at the end of Bible study like we always do and prayed for my pain that I've been having with my arthritis. And praise God, I didn't ask for healing, I just asked for it to be eased, and he's healed me. So I don't have no more pain. I've not had no pain since we prayed that night.
Sure.
Yeah! And I could hardly lift my arms before. They would just hurt so bad and just hurt so much, but I can do it now. But we also had prayed for my son and my friend Sean. And so when I went home that night, my son didn't come home. So I'm texting him wanting to know where he's at, and he's like, I'm not coming home tonight. And I kept asking what's going on, and he didn't want to tell me, and then he started getting ugly, and so I was like, okay, I'm not going to push it. I went to my room and I prayed. Put it in God's hands. And the next morning he come and he was angry. And so I wouldn't open the door. And I started to try to I was about to try and diffuse it the way that I was taught through all these therapists and specialists that this is how you handle it. Well, Holy Spirit said, I'm happy. Go to your room. So I went to my room. Prayer mat. I've never got on my knees with a prayer mat and my Bible in hand and prayed the scripture out loud. But I did this time. And when I did, I got quiet. My son left. And then my friend Sean came in my room and he's going through some difficulties. I thought he was in rehab. He left. He's relapsed. And so, anyway, I prayed with him after that. And then he went to sleep. And later on, when he got up, he was a different person and started telling me that I didn't have the Spirit in me and I didn't know what I was talking about. And I was just, I couldn't believe I was hearing all this from him. And so I was like, the Holy Spirit's like, nope, don't believe him, don't listen. And I started singing my worship music and praising God. And hallelujah, Sean left. And so I'm just keeping him in prayer now that he comes back to God. But God's just been so amazing. And he told me, he reassured me, your breakthrough is coming. It's coming. So just keep being obedient, praying and staying in the Word. And just I'm just amazed at how much praying scripture out loud really works. Holy Spirit equipped me, and he was there, and he handled everything for me. It was just beautiful. It goes perfectly with today's sermon, and I'm just happy to share out with everybody.
Amen. Through simple prayer, intentional prayer, because we're living and doing the things that God wants us to do. She asked for some healing. She got complete healing from her arthritis. And not since that day has she had any problem with it. Praise be to God.
Hallelujah.
And when she was under attack and her son was not in the right mind and pounding on the door, when she started praying the Psalms out loud on her knees, as she said, the spirit in him departed and he went a different way, quiet. And she had quiet the rest of the day. And then when the enemy started attacking her mind because of her prayer life, because of her devoted life with God, her helmet of salvation protected her from those lies of the enemy and the breastplate of righteousness from his arrows. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. This is how God works, but we have to do our part. We have to spend time with him daily, as your pastor always is telling you and encouraging, because I see the effect it has on this woman. I see the effect it has on that man back there and everybody else who has been plugging in the same way. I'm seeing the same things happening in their lives.
Hallelujah.
Would you like more of that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. So brothers and sisters, I declare over you that we have been fully restored by the grace of God. We are no longer an angry church, are we? No, we are a joy-filled church. We're no longer despaired, are we? No, we have the hope of Christ in us. And we are no longer grieving because we see God working in our church and in our community. This is a different church than the one I came to 2 years ago last June.
Amen.
We have been fully restored by the grace of God, and now that we have been restored, I declare and I decree over you that it is our time to serve God by bringing the light and hope of Christ to those who are in the greatest need, those who are walking in spiritual darkness and who are desperately, desperately seeking a Savior. And so I will be encouraging others of us to go with us next year to the Aldersgate Conference. It will be in June. And their conference on the Holy Spirit living us. More and more people in our church that move from the indwelling of the Holy Spirit to the infilling of the Holy Spirit, the more emotional healing, the more physical healing, the more spiritual healing will become a part of our everyday ministry here at Firebaugh-Mendota United Methodist Church. And who wouldn't want more of that? Amen? So for all these things, let us give all praise, all glory, all honor to God the Father, to God the Son, and to God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Do you feel like worshiping?
Yeah.
Nope, we're going to do an offering first. Offerings, which are for you, Lord, which are all from you, Lord. The things, everything we have is from you, Lord. So we give back to you. It's already yours. We ask you to bless it, Lord. Bless the hands who have given it, and bless those for whom it is given, Lord. That these offerings will be used to build up, to equip the church, Lord, to reach those who are lost, those who have been forgotten, Lord, those who are desperately in need of a Savior. So we thank you and we praise you, Lord, because we see your good hand in all of this, Lord, and we're obedient, Lord. We're committed to be obedient to your will and to your purposes in our lives. So bless this church, bless these people, and bless, Lord, all of this for your kingdom. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And while you're standing now, let us sing and worship as we sing Holy Water.
Sound of
for the mighty outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon the congregation, upon these people, and even all those who are tuning in online, Lord. Pour out your Spirit upon them, Lord, by your grace and your mercy. We give you thanks, and we give you praise, for Lord, it's such a joy to experience your glory, to be in your presence, Lord, and to hear you speaking to us in clear and certain terms. So we thank you, we praise you, and we glorify your name. So you are all now once again anointed. You are all now filled with God's Holy Spirit. It's His light that is in you, and you are His light bearers to go out into the world, to go out into the darkness, to bring light into the darkness of other people's life so they can come to see, come to know, and come to experience the same saving grace of Jesus Christ that we know today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I release you. I send you out. Go out this day. Go out this week to love and serve your Lord, your God. Go out in peace.
Yeah.